Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to TechGeek webinar series, our endeavor to empower techies. We believe that sharing of knowledge is the key to enhance our skills and grow us as professionals. With this principle in mind, we have initiated a series of webinars conducted by industry experts to give you all a crisp insight of various domains. The topic of today's session is choosing between native web and hybrid mobile application development. Our guest speaker today is Mr. Kapil Madan. Mr. Kapil Madan is a consultant, Mobility Solutions at IBM India Software Labs, where he evangelizes IBM's mobility solutions to clients and partners. As consultant, Mobility Solutions, he works with clients and partners in adoption of mobility solutions, assists customers in identifying and delivering solutions leveraging IBM mobile offerings and expertise to provide competitive and operational advantage. So without further delay, I introduce you all to our guest speaker, Mr. Madan. Over to you, Mr. Madan.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much for taking time out for attending this webinar. My name is Kapil Madan, and I work as consultant mobility with IBM Software Services for WebSphere. Mobile development brings in specific set of challenges. There is fragmentation of mobile technology and platforms, starting right from form factors, whether it's smartphone or tablets, to application types, web, native, hybrid. The fragmentation in mobile space also requires rapid pace of innovation, as mobile landscape is evolving at much faster pace with new operating system releases, new device types introduced in the marketplace. So today in this webinar, we are going to focus on understanding the mobile application development options available to us. Drawn from our expertise and customer experience, I'll provide an overview of different characteristics of each of these different application types and compare the pros and cons of each, as well as discuss how each methodology can impact your business. I hope that this webinar will help make you a decision as to the right approach for your mobile goals. Please feel free to submit questions through the webinar console at any time while we go through the webinar. So in our discussion today, I'll explain the difference between native web and hybrid mobile apps and how these apply to enterprise mobile initiatives. We'll start by looking at native applications, which you might think of as a conventional mobile app. We'll then look at web applications, which are written in HTML and run inside the mobile browser. But you may be a bit surprised that what all they can do. Then we'll have a look at hybrid applications, which again are a very interesting combination of the two approaches, native and web app, a combination which is especially important for the enterprise context. Before we proceed though, I wanted to note that there is no official definition of a native web app or a hybrid app. In this webinar, we'll use the terms as they are generally accepted in the industry, though some companies and experts may have slightly different interpretation of these terms. Now let's dig into details of what these application types are. Just to put our discussion in context, let's take a look at the screenshots of a few prominent native applications. We'll discuss in detail in the next slides what native application means. In the top row, we have got this iPhone Skype app, which provides voice over IP services through the mobile, the Twitter and Foursquare apps. These screenshots are from Android. And on your right corner is the Shazam app, which listens through the microphone of mobile device to identify songs that you're listening to. On the bottom row, we can see WordLens, a cool augmented reality application, which translates words on the fly by processing the images captured on the mobile device video camera. And no discussion about native apps can be complete without showing at least a picture of Angry Birds, which anybody having a smartphone would have played, and it's a must-have. The thing about all of these apps have in common is that they are all purely native. But what does that actually means. So in this slide, I try to summarize the most prominent characteristics of native applications. First of all, native applications have binary executable files that are explicitly downloaded to the device and stored there. The installation process could be initiated by the user or in some cases by the IT department of an enterprise. The most popular way to get native applications is by visiting an app store like iTunes or Android Marketplace. But mobile operating systems also provide additional methods to get the app onto the device. Anyways, once the app has been stored on the device, the user launches it just like any other service of the mobile device. For example, on an iPhone or an Android device, the app is launched from the home screen. Once the native application has been launched, it interfaces directly with the mobile operating system without any intermediary or container application. The application is free to access all the APIs made available by the OS vendor, and in many cases have a look and feel which is typical of that specific mobile OS. Now let's deep dive into these points a little deeper, starting with the first two, the binary and distributed. The process of obtaining a binary executable image and preparing it for distribution is basically the same for all the leading mobile operating systems, be it iPhone, Android, BlackBerry, or Windows. The developers write the source code of the application, which is in a human readable form, and create additional resources such as images, audio segments, or configuration info, and various OS-specific declaration files. They then use the tools provided by the operating system vendor to compile the source code and sometime also link into it in order to create an executable in the binary format, and then package that binary executable together with the resources of the application in order to obtain a package that can be distributed to the mobile devices through app stores or any other means. These tools and few other utilities and files are usually called the SDK of the mobile OS. SDK is a platform specific, and each mobile OS comes with its own unique tools. But the process is quite similar for all of them. So iPhone would have its own SDK, Android would come with its own SDK, and so is for other platforms. We'll have a look in the next slides on the different operating systems, starting with iOS. To create an iOS application for iPhone or iPad, developer will write a code in Objective-C, C language, or C++. They would then compile and package this application using Apple's tool. Tools, they all come bundled in a single IDE called Xcode. The output from the packager is called a .app file, and it can be submitted to the Apple iTunes App Store. Similarly, to create a native Android app, developers will write their code in Java. For some versions of Android, developers can also include C or C++ code, but this complicates the process and requires additional tools. The developer will then compile and package that application using the Android SDK. So this is the SDK that you will use to compiling and linking, which has a nice integration with an Eclipse IDE. The output from the package is called .apk. It can be submitted to the Android marketplace and can be transferred to a device from the web. For BlackBerry, again the process is very similar. We start with Java source files. In case of BlackBerry, the SDK is called BlackBerry Java Plugin for Eclipse. We use the SDK tools to create a binary, package it with resources. In case of BlackBerry, it's called a .cod code file. And you optionally either submit it to the BlackBerry app world or use over-the-air installation to download to the device. And as you might expect, the process is again similar on Windows Phone 7, except that the source code is written in a different language, C# or any other Microsoft language. The SDK is integrated into Visual Studio, and the resulting distributable is called .xap. The App Store here is Windows Phone Market. On a side note, for Microsoft, there is a regional development option called XNA, which is optimized for game development and allows applications to be written for Windows Phone as well as Xbox 360. So if you see in all of these, right, the process is exactly the same. You write a source code, you have a different IDE to compile it into, you package, the package is different, and just submit it for the App Store. But as we can see, though the overall process of development is the same for all the platforms, the specifics are different. So if you see, Apple requires Objective-C, Android requires Java, BlackBerry requires Java, Windows requires C#, VB.NET, tooling is again different, executable files, different application scores are different. When we write code for one platform, we can't use it for others. This means that the process of developing and maintaining a mobile application for multiple operating systems is very expensive. To build a single application, you would need 4 set of people to understand 4 different languages, go through the entire life cycle from development till test. Making the entire mobile application process is expensive. So the next question is, if it's so expensive to build native applications, why do we write native applications at all? Because there are certain benefits which only native applications can provide. To understand them, let's look at how native applications interface with the mobile OS where they execute. So on this slide, this is a view of how a native application will interface with the mobile operating system and will get access to all the internal APIs calls. So once the native application is installed on the mobile device and user launches it, it interacts with the mobile operating system through proprietary API calls that the operating system exposes. And this is true for all platforms, be it Android, iPhone, BlackBerry, or Windows. It is through these API calls that the application can get access to the different hardware components of the device. So all these hardware components, using these APIs, application can directly interact right from the touch screen or the keyboard, can render graphics, connect to the networks, process audio received from the microphone, it can play sounds through the speakers or headphones, or receive images and videos from the camera. It can even access the GPS, receive orientation information, and of course read and write files on the solid state disk, or access any other hardware elements available today on a mobile phone devices. Now there are two important things to note about these APIs. First, on the upside, these are very fast and powerful. They let you do amazing things because you have direct access to these proprietary APIs, and they really tap the full potential of mobile device. The downside is that these APIs are proprietary. Each mobile OS provides its own unique APIs for each function. So if you have to write a native application in a different, not only in a different programming language for a different mobile OS, the differences in APIs makes porting of an application to multiple devices even more expensive. So if you're writing an Android application, you not only have to write in Java, but to port that application to iPhone, you also need to understand the low-level APIs which iOS provides in order, along with learning Objective-C. That makes the whole proposition pretty expensive. So in addition to providing the low-level hardware access services we just saw, mobile operating system also provides higher-level services that are important to personal mobile experience and made available to the user. For example, browsing the web, managing a calendar, contacts books, photo album, and of course the ability to make phone calls or send and receive text messages. So if you see at the bottom, these are the low-level APIs which we saw. And then there is a set of high-level APIs ranging from Google Toolkit, Calendar API, Contacts, Push, Browser, and many more. So these APIs are exposed by mobile OS in two ways. First of all, the OS comes with built-in applications, which we call as native applications, which lets user directly access those services. Each mobile operating system comes with own set of built-in apps. On this slide, you can see a few examples from both Android and OS, built-in apps. The other way the mobile OS exposes these high-level services is by making them accessible to downloadable native apps. So they provide a high-level API calls, which along with the low-level APIs you can use to access calendars, to access contacts, to access push APIs as well as browser. These built-in APIs apps are, the built-in apps are usually allowed to do much more things than these APIs than the downloadable apps. But for example, an app can read the user contact list, add events to the calendar, initiate the sending of an email. Other APIs let downloadable apps access various cloud-based services that are provided by the OS vendors, such as push notifications or in-application purchases. Another important set of APIs that the operating system provides is the GUI toolkit. Each mobile operating system comes with its own set of user interface components, which are called native UI components, such as buttons, input fields, sliders, menus, tab bars, dialogs. Applications that choose to make use of these components inherit the look and feel of that mobile operating system. And these native UI components usually provide a very smooth user interface. Though it's important to note that each mobile operating system comes with their own palette of UI components, which means that if you want to build an application that works across multiple operating systems, the designer of the application must be familiar with the UI components provided by each operating system in order to design an application that works for that user. So net-net, build a native application, you need to understand differences in GUI toolkits, you need to understand APIs, you need to understand different languages which each native platform provides. Let's take a step back and focus on one specific built-in native application, the browser. Today, mobile devices comes with very powerful browsers with support for many HTML5 capabilities, CSS3 and advanced JavaScript. Here on this slide, I have specifically highlighted the browsers that come bundled with iOS and Android. But even the BlackBerry devices as well as Windows devices have come with a top-notch browser. HTML5 JavaScript have become so powerful today that it is now possible to develop very advanced and complicated applications using them. And this actually brings us to our next category, mobile web applications. Just like native apps, let's start with having a look at a few examples of web apps. So of course, we are all familiar with mobile browsing. This is the most trivial use of the browser. And I'm sure you have all seen mobile optimized websites, such as those operated by Google, Wikipedia. These websites recognize when they are being contacted by a smartphone, for example, and they serve up HTML pages that have been designed to provide a comfortable touch experience on a small screen size. So they automatically, based on your device type, they render a version which is most suitable for your device size and they present that particular mobile page. Some companies have created a mobile website that looks somewhat like a native app. One interesting example of this approach is that of an application developed by Dremel, that's a hardware tools manufacturer, which have created a mobile version of their product catalog. What I found especially interesting here is that in conjunction with the site itself, they created QR code which allows navigation to a specific product from a printed ad. So the user will scan the QR code with a QR reader application using the phone's camera, application will detect the QR code and will redirect it to the right place within the online catalog. If you see, the look and feel is exactly similar to what a native app is, but it's not a native app. Now, there are companies who don't stop at just making the site look like an application. Take Google, for example. The YouTube web application, which not only looks very similar to their native application, but it provides very similar functionality, and it even prompts you to sort of install it on your phone by adding it onto your home screen when you visit the site. Now, as you can see in this iPhone screenshot, the installation creates a shortcut which is indistinguishable from those used to launch native apps. When the user taps the shortcut, the YouTube web app is launched. So the user experience, from a user experience perspective, there is no difference between a web app and a native app. And then here is a small web app. This is written by an Australian developer that takes things even further. This is a small touch sketchpad written entirely in HTML5 and JavaScript. When you slide your finger on the screen, a pencil appears, like in the, if you see on the right hand side, 2B web app. And you can draw on the pad with wavy lines and everything. This is a great demonstration of the power of HTML5. What more, this app uses an HTML5 feature which enables it to run when the phone is in the offline mode and it is not connected to web server at all. Again, using an HTML5 feature. And it saves your drawing locally on the mobile device. Another nice thing about this application is that on iPhone, it uses a feature of the browser that lets installed web application remove the browser Chrome in a portrait mode, so that the user can't really tell it is running inside a browser. So if you see on that screenshot, it's full screen, it's not even running. User have no means of knowing that it's running inside a web browser. So these four examples of browser-based pages can really help us understand the wide spectrum of offerings available on the mobile web today. On one extreme, we have what I would like to call pure mobile web apps, which are written entirely in HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And the key difference is that they are served from a web server, but are almost indistinguishable to the user from native apps. They are installed on the homepage, launched like native apps. They have an interactive user interface, which is highly optimized for touch screens. And while data is retrieved from the servers using AJAX, the logic for rendering the user interface resides entirely on the mobile device, which means that it can be very responsive, doesn't require long waits for a response from the web server. And because the server doesn't render the UI, the application can have an offline mode, allowing it to function without network connectivity. Now, on the other extreme, what we have is what we might call as pure mobile websites. The user visits them by typing a URL in a browser, and they have a navigational UI, which means that the visitors mostly navigate between pages that display static data. Pages have a generic look and feel, so that they look like web pages. Logic for rendering these pages is executed on the server, for example using PHP, JSP or Python, which means that the user usually waits for the pages to be retrieved from the network, and which also means that any interactive functionality requires network connectivity and doesn't really work when the phone is in offline mode. So you see the spectrum of options available within web apps. On one side, we have so much proximity to native app that it is almost indistinguishable. On the other side, it's bringing the internet to the mobile. Along with those two extremes, we have a very wide range of possibilities, with most websites actually making use of their own mix of app features in a way that puts somewhere in between pure mobile web apps and pure mobile websites. So as you can see, mobile web apps are a very promising trend. And to help developers create the client-side user interface of these mobile web apps, there is a growing number of JavaScript toolkits that help do just that. Like Accenture Touch, jQuery, Dojo Mobile. Without getting into the specifics of each toolkit, we can see that most of them generate user interfaces that look very closely, provide very close look and feel of the native applications. They execute entirely within the browser of the mobile device and make use of the newest JavaScript, CSS, HTML features available on the browsers. So if you see both from the jQuery and Accenture, it's very hard to distinguish whether it's a native app or a web app. So now we have been mentioning HTML5 over the last couple of minutes, and I would like to take a moment to explain what HTML5 really means. So HTML5 is the current target of the HTML standardization process. In many ways, HTML5 signals the transition of HTML from a page definition language into a powerful technology for creating browser-based applications. In fact, many parts of HTML5 will just be a snapshot of ongoing effort driven towards by a consortium of companies whose aim is to keep evolving HTML in this manner. It's a work in progress, but a very large portion of features that are available, that are part of HTML5, is already available in mobile browsers. Here are a few examples of HTML5 features already available on most mobile browsers or will be available soon. For starters, HTML5 provides many client-side graphics capability with the canvas element, SVG, and things like rounded corners in CSS3. HTML5 has several mechanisms that enable offline support, such as application caching, offline storage. HTML5 has already defined APIs for accessing location data, and there is work on defining new APIs for device orientation as well as device-specific APIs. So let's recap, what are the characteristics of mobile web applications? Written in HTML, CSS, JavaScript. Their code is executed by the browser and not by the operating system. There are several ways to launch them, and the installation is optional. They can easily support multiple operating systems and can be extended with device-specific enhancements to make them behave more like native applications. So if web apps can do so much, who needs native? Now, web apps are very promising. There are great things that you can be done with them today, and they will quickly become even more powerful approach as HTML continues to evolve rapidly. There are still important limitations of web apps. To understand them, let's have a look at how web applications interface with the mobile device. So you remember this slide, right? We just saw how a native app interacts with a mobile application, where a native app has a direct access to the all the low-level APIs provided by the operating system. Now, web apps work differently. Unlike native apps, which are independent executables that interface directly with the operating systems, web applications run within the browser. Browser itself is a native app, and it has direct access to the operating system APIs. But it only exposes some of them to the web applications that run inside. So while native apps have full access to the device, there are many features that web apps can only access in a limited fashion, and even others that web apps cannot access at all. This will change in future because HTML is evolving and there is specific work being done to allow such things as access to low-level APIs, but we are not there yet. One specific element of the browser that I wanted to highlight is the rendering engine. This is the heart of the browser. It's the part that translates the HTML, CSS, and JavaScript into a real live user interface. Today, all leading smartphone vendors are using the same rendering engine in their device. The rendering engine is called WebKit, and it's an open source project led mostly by Apple and Google. and it has the largest amount of HTML5 features implemented already. So while vendor makes their own changes to the webkit, the browsers still have a nice level of compatibility between them. There are of course differences, extension, and each version of OS has a slightly different browser, but the differences are not huge. So now that we understand both native and web apps, let's compare the two. Native applications have a significant advantage that they can give full access to the features of the device and get a native look and feel, while web apps are more limited in what they can do, and the native look and feel can be achieved only in part on many phones. Furthermore, even though mobile applications can be quite fast, native applications really run faster. It's important to mention two things about this at this point. The execution speed is dependent on specific mobile operating system as well as on the hardware capabilities of the mobile device, just like the normal computer would. Looking forward, we anticipate browser performance to continue to improve. OS vendors are continuously improving them and adding things like JavaScript optimization and hardware acceleration. But still, if you need powerful computation or a super responsive game-like user interface, we prefer native. The obvious downside of native application development is the cost, because there is a significant penalty for each supported mobile operating system. And this is not only for initial development, but also for ongoing maintenance. As and when new versions of a native OS comes up, you have to migrate your application to support those newer versions. And given the differences between, you have to take care right from programming language, GUI toolkits, low-level APIs, it ends up being a very expensive proposition. On the other hand, native apps are available on major app stores, whereas mobile web apps are only available on smaller, lesser-known app stores. The downside of app store process is the painful approval process which one has to go through when you submit the app and every time you release an update. So which one should you choose? That depends on your specific needs. Some of our customers go native, at least one operating system. Some prefer web. Some do a combination of both. Now, introducing hybrid apps. Some of our customers choose a very flexible solution, which is to create an application which combines both native and web elements, or in other words, a hybrid app. Let's examine this approach. What are the characteristics of hybrid app? A hybrid app is a native application with embedded HTML. It has all the benefits of native applications, full access to all low-level APIs, app store presence, etc. Selected portions of the hybrid app are written using web technologies. The web portion of the application can either be downloaded from the web or could be packaged within the application. Now let's look at how does a hybrid app interacts with mobile devices as compared to native or web application. So let's go back to this familiar diagram and see how it works. As you can see on the left, hybrid app has two separate components. First of all, there is a native portion of the app. This part can call all the APIs provided by the operating system. This means it has free access to everything that the device offers, including things like camera, microphone, and even the high-level services, like the calendar or address book. The second portion is the web portion of the application. This part is written in HTML, CSS, JavaScript, which are executed by the same rendering engine that was the heart of the browser that comes with the device. So by default, this web code can only access the services that the rendering engine exposes. So theoretically, you might think it has the same limitation as the web apps do. However, the native portion of the application has control over the rendering engine, and as such, it can create what you might call as a bridge, which allows the web portion of the application to access all of the operating system APIs. Now, the developers of the application can create their own bridge, or they can use a ready-made one. The most popular such bridge today is an open source library called PhoneGap, which comes with both native and JavaScript endpoints and provides a JavaScript interface to select device capabilities, which is consistent across operating systems. Let's take a look at hybrid application examples. There are many hybrid applications out there. For example, Bank of America mobile application is a hybrid one. Morgan Stanley has a hybrid application. Some of the pages in the official Facebook application are in HTML, and there are many more examples. One specific example I would like to highlight, which was created on IBM mobile platform, is the Lotte Card app. This was developed by the Financial Solutions of Korea. This application has a large number of screens. I only introduced three of them here. They can help us understand few points about hybrid application. First of all, you might not notice it by looking at them, but the two screens on the left were written entirely in HTML5. The screen on the right is an augmented reality feature which overlays icons on top of real-time video image from the camera, which is pure native code. So this one is a pure native code. These two are HTML5. So this app lets the user switch between the screens. So that is the power of hybrid, that you can switch from HTML to native. And the user doesn't notice that one screen was implemented in HTML and the other is native, providing a seamless interface, seamless user experience to the user. Another interesting point is that this application is available for both Android and iPhone. Most of the HTML, CSS and JavaScript code is shared between the two implementations, and only the native portion has to be implemented separately for OS. So that's the power of hybrid, that you can build once and deploy anywhere. Now let's look at how a hybrid app development is done. How do we create a hybrid application? Remember that a hybrid application is first of all a native application from an executable point. So we have to first create that. So the native application should be coded in a way that launches the HTML rendering engine whenever appropriate. And now that we have a native app, there are two primary ways that we can get the HTML, CSS and JavaScript into that app. The first way is the more conventional way. That is what people prefer when they say hybrid app. That is, we take the HTML source, put them on a web server, have the app instruct the rendering engine to browse to that web server. This approach has a slight drawback because it introduces a delay. So you have a native app, you have a hybrid app running, which is reaching out for HTML resources hosted on an external server. So there would be a delay, and the HTML pages will not be displayed till they are downloaded from the server. On the other hand, it has a benefit that the HTML portion of the application can have minor updates made to them without the requiring the app to be submitted again to the App Store. The other way is to pack the HTML sources as part of the resources. Some mobile OS vendors offer development tools that create hybrid app. For example, BlackBerry New Webworks and these tools use this means of packaging. So if the web resources are packaged within the application, it means there is no delay for the user because the HTML and the other files can be retrieved directly. So to summarize, let's look at all three development approaches compared to each other. Native excels in performance, device access, suffers in cost and updates. Web is much simpler, less expensive, easier to update, but currently more limited. Hybrid provides a middle ground, which in many situations is the best of the both worlds, especially if you are targeting multiple operating systems. The question is, which one should you choose? That really depends on your specific needs. There isn't a single approach that will work for everyone. So to provide you a few more tips that will help you decide, let's go to the next slide. This is a summary of the spectrum of mobile application design. So you see on one side, mobile web UI, HTML5 mobile, which is executing in mobile web browser. On the other side is your App Store distribution, which is your HTML5 hybrid and pure native. Now, as I said, there is no single approach is right for everyone, right? The important thing to understand here is that there is no single development approach that will fit all needs of all companies. Different organizations will have different requirements, such as application functionality, target audience, IT resources, and of course, limited budget and time. Let's look at the trade-offs with each of these options on a scale of user experience and cost and time to the market. In this web of uncertainty, one thing is clear, right? Companies today face a trade-off between user experience and application functionality. Challenges becomes choosing the right development approach that will balance your requirement within your budget and time to market constraint. Now, choosing what is right for you. Native, I have gathered a list of scenarios out here to help guide you to decide on the approach that would be help you take a decision on what is right for your company. Let's start with the native approach. If your organization or the use case that you plan for the application fits into these criteria, then the native development approach is right for you. If you have existing native skills, right? So if you already have existing native skills in-house, then putting into work will not require significant new investments. If you are going to build only for a single mobile operating system, that is that you are aiming to release only a mobile application to a limited target audience. For example, an internal app which is for an organization which is standardized, the BlackBerry, and you don't need multi-platform coverage, then native could make sense for you. Set native functionality. Some applications are built around a single functionality. Take Skype for example. Voice over IP access and access to the user contacts. Those are the key elements of this application. And they are only possible to be developed natively. For such kind of an application, web technologies are not even an option at all. The fourth criteria is a rich UI. Now when we say rich UI, even an HTML5 provides richer UI with all the JavaScript frameworks. But certain specific applications like games that requires very rich, responsive user interface. Web technologies add a layer of complexity. It doesn't mean that web using web or hybrid is a complete no-no. So you have to evaluate are you building a game? Are you building an application that requires responsiveness just like a game? Then yes, native is the right option for you. Let's move on and go to the web scenarios. What scenarios are supported by direct distribution? Some organizations prefer distributing their apps in a manner that is controlled internally and are not subjected to long and uncertain approval processes. In such cases, using purely web technologies can completely circumvent the app store process and allow the organization to fully control the distribution of an app. Now, this is just one option. Today, there is this concept of enterprise app stores, which is being offered by various products, which help you to bypass the consumer app stores. Even Apple has an enterprise app license where you can build your apps, enterprise apps, and do not go towards Apple application store. Pilot application. When comparing price and time to market of a native app versus hybrid app, using web technologies to create a pilot version of app can be very compelling and cost-effective tactic. If you want to see and gather user feedback and you are still not able to decide whether you should go for native or hybrid way, you can use a web app, quickly launch an application, do a pilot with the selected users, and then decide which is the right approach for you. Visibility. Further to the distribution, which we already discussed, right? Another benefit of creating a web application is visibility in search engine results, which in many cases can gain significantly more eyeballs. This is true for a B2C kind of an application where you want people to discover your applications. Now, as for the hybrid approach, it's breaking the trade-off. It's all about breaking the development trade-off. Using the hybrid approach, you can enjoy both best of the both worlds. On one hand, the native container or the ability to implement native code. That allows a developer to take full advantage of all the different features and capabilities of modern mobile devices. On the other hand, all the portions of code that are written using web languages can be shared across different environments. So you're writing once in a HTML5, and the same code base can be used for all four platforms. That makes the development and ongoing maintenance process centralized, shorter, and cost effective. Second factor, just like native, is about end-to-end skills. Web development skills are very common, can easily be found in many organizations. By choosing the hybrid approach, web developers are able to build applications with nothing but pure HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript knowledge, while delivering a native user experience. Consider the future. HTML5 is rapidly growing in both availability and capabilities. You would all agree with me and with many analysts that when I say HTML is very likely to become the default technology for front-end application development. By writing most of the application in HTML and using native only when where needed, companies can make sure the investment that they make today do not become obsolete tomorrow. As HTML functionality becomes richer and addresses more and more of mobile application requirements. Now, speaking of future advancement in the market, I would like to spend a few minutes exploring these projections. So here is a short list of what I believe that we will be witnessing in the mobile market in the very near future. Further fragmentation of mobile devices and technologies. So every day we hear about new devices coming out, new form factors, 6-inch tablets, 7-inch tablets, 10-inch tablets, which in turn will continue to increase the overall cost which are associated with mobile application development, integration, and ongoing management. Accelerated mobile adoption by consumers and within the enterprise of mission-critical application, which increases the requirements around security, scalability, and ongoing control. New device features and complementing technologies such as near-field communication, geolocation, augmented reality, social networks, and others, which will undoubtedly give rise to new types and new use cases of mobile application, be it in finance, e-commerce, travel, health, communication, or any other industry for that matter. And the new distribution channel for the applications, both public and private, which are allowing organizations to easily place the application in the hands of the users, quickly deploy updates, and manage the entire portfolio of applications without going through a long approval and submission cycle. So one conclusion is obvious from this list. The choice between hybrid, native, and web, that's a major one, but not the only one. Companies that are just forming their mobile strategy must also consider the future trends that we just mentioned and choose a comprehensive solution, one that will not only support development of their first mobile application, but would also be flexible enough to support the development of all future applications, regardless of their development approach, one that would support the secure and scalable integration of the applications into the ever-evolving IT infrastructure, backend system, and also allow them to monitor and control their entire portfolio of applications from one centralized interface. So this brings us to an end of understanding mobile application development options. Next, I will provide you a short overview of what IBM Mobile Solutions have to offer. So the IBM solution for mobile enterprises is IBM Mobile Foundation, which provides solution to build, connect, manage, and secure your entire mobile enterprise. It contains IBM WorkLight, IBM FCR Cast Iron, and IBM Endpoint Manager for mobile devices. At its core is IBM WorkLight, a company which IBM acquired in January. It has all the great features for what goes on the device, what goes on the server, application management, application security. For integration of mobile applications to the cloud and backend applications like SAP. We have IBM WebSphere Cast Iron. And for the enterprise use, where you have employees bring your own device, you have to manage and secure these devices, this is where IBM Endpoint Manager for mobile devices brings value. So the next slide shows the complete enterprise framework offering for mobile computing from IBM. As you can see, it comprises of the core mobile enterprise mobile application flow platform being provided by IBM WorkLight, IBM Endpoint Manager for mobile devices, a rational collaborative lifecycle management for entire end-to-end mobile application lifecycle management, and the backend connectivity provided by IBM WorkLight to consume and expose your existing applications to the mobile. So at the core of IBM mobile solution is IBM WorkLight, which is an open mobile application platform for smartphone and tablets that helps organizations of all sizes for efficiently develop, run and manage both HTML5 hybrid and native applications. The solution leverages standard-based technologies, tools, and it does not employ any automatic code translator, proprietary interpreter, or unpopular scripting languages. It is 100% open. IBM WorkLight helps the clients reduce time to market, cost, complexity of development, while providing a rich user interface across a variety of devices. So you can, it allows users to use any of the JavaScript frameworks, be it Tencha, jQuery Mobile, or Dojo, leveraging your existing skills. Using this technology, developers can maximize usability of their code base while optimizing the application for unique design and functional requirements. It provides build once, run anywhere concept, where you just code once, and it can be deployed for Android, iOS, BlackBerry, Microsoft, and not only mobile application, you can also create mobile website with a single code base, Facebook applications, and Adobe AI applications. It provides functionality so that you can create different runtime skins for different resolutions outside your core code base, where your design team can write code in CSS3 for specific to leverage the resolutions and form factors while you write the core functionality in HTML5 and native languages. It provides an end-to-end application lifecycle management, uses standard-based languages. It takes care of end-to-end security, right from on-device encryption of user data, providing single sign-on mechanism for various enterprise applications installed on the same handset, providing a SSL encryption between the handset to the WorkLight server, provides protection against reverse engineering vulnerabilities, and supports multi-factor authentication. And it leverages IBM's strength of enterprise integration by providing direct access to the backend systems to leverage existing SOA services or backend integrations. It provides the end-to-end application management right from application distribution, version management, and it provides the unique feature of remote disabling of applications and directly updating the resources into the application without going through the approval cycle of the App Store. It provides a detailed analytics and user report, and it's based on proven IBM middleware WebSphere application server, providing it a reliable, highly scalable and available platform. IBM WorkLight architecture comprises of four components: a WorkLight Studio, which is the WorkLight IDE, a device runtime, which becomes part of the mobile application which runs on the device, a WorkLight server, which is the mobile middleware, and the WorkLight console, which provides version management, push management, reporting and analytics. So IBM WorkLight Studio is an Eclipse-based IDE, which combines native and standard web applications technologies in one multi-platform app. It helps do environment-specific optimization, provides third-party library integration. It It provides a device SDK integration for Android, BlackBerry, and rest of the devices, and help you connect with the backend connectivity utilities. So let's look at what IBM Worklight application types are. So it supports right from a web browser access web application to hybrid applications and native applications. And hybrid, it supports both hybrid web applications as well as mixed applications, which combine both web as well as native. Some of the key capabilities of IBM Worklight Studio. It provides a what you see, what is what you get UI construction, drag and drop component, quickly build the user interface of your mobile application, improved code assist to quickly help you build your web application, mobile web application, provides a seamless integration with the native SDKs for testing on the simulators and emulators. It provides a fast preview in browser, the device simulation. So it comes with a number of device simulators. You don't need to run them on an actual device to see, but you can actually choose a device type, do a preview. And it provides a unique combination of hybrid coding, which is combining native and web. So if you see, you can combine both HTML5 and native-based web pages in the same application. You can call native code from HTML-based pages and vice versa. And you can also display HTML and native components together on the same page, giving a seamless user experience. Now, why mix hybrid and native? That's a question that everybody asks. So, you reuse, from a reusability perspective, you code majority of the code in reusable web languages, maximize your user experience, and achieve unique functionality like augmented reality with the native code. Going to the IBM Worklight server, this is the mobile middleware piece for the Worklight. It provides distribution of mobile web applications, provides the enterprise connectivity for secure client-server connectivity. So any of your backend applications would get connected through adapters running this mobile middleware. It is responsible for authentication enforcement. So all of your mobile applications, you can enable authentication on those, and those will be integrated with Worklight server, which can integrate back with your enterprise LDAPs or other authentication frameworks to enforce authentication. Client control, which comprises of your application version management, you can remotely disable particular version of an application and force the user for automatic upgrade of application. Unified push notification, and provide a unified push notification framework in which, as a developer, you don't need to focus on just like build once, code once, deploy anywhere. Similarly, write a single piece of code for sending notification to irrespective of the device type. It provides the aggregation of the user statistics, how your users are using your application, what OS are they using it on, how they are using it. Next is the device runtime components, which is a device, small device component, which gets compiled as part of your application and runs on the device handset. It provides secure server connectivity, authentication in collaboration with the middleware server, remote disable and notification. It is responsible for push registration, event reporting, which we just saw in the Worklight server. It also provides a cross-platform compatibility layer, so the users, shielding users from nitty-gritties of each platform. It enables the runtime skins and also provides a secure interpret storage. This is the IBM Worklight console, which is the console for the Worklight server, from where which provides a user interface for application version management, push management, viewing users reports and analytics, reports of custom application events, and provides administrative dashboards for deployed application installed adapters, and data export to your enterprise systems, business intelligence systems. Next is your IBM Software Services for Mobile. So IBM Software Services team is of technical comprises, technical specialists, solution architects, who are subject matter expertise in IBM mobile platform. And we have an extensive experience in solution integration and cross-industry solution development and delivery. And we offer services for mobile discovery, architecture skills, and mobile development of mobile solutions. An architecture offering comprises of understanding your business drivers, current integration capabilities, pain point, identify and prioritize your candidate mobile application. A mobile discovery workshop comprises of a detailed assessment of steps required to expose your enterprise data to mobile application. That is from 1 to 2 days. A mobile development bootcamp, this is a customized training for enabling your developers in building mobile solutions. And support for your productions, which is implementing tangible solutions, demonstrating technical capabilities and business value. And thank you all. With this, I'm to end of this webinar.
Thanks for the insightful presentation, Mr. Madan. Let's quickly take up the questions now. Please read out the questions from your questions pane and their answers so that all our users may listen to the commendable insights. Over to you, Mr. Madan. Madan, are you able to see the questions yet?
I know, I'm just looking and
okay.
Not able to see them. Just a second, I'm just looking at the questions.
Okay.
So I'm just taking questions one by one. Can't a HTML5 web app be put on Play Store, iStore? So the answer to that is no, because it's a web app and web app can't be put. You can create a hybrid app and you can put it up on the web store. To be placed on a app store, it has to be a native app, and a web app is not native. A hybrid app qualifies as a native app. So the next question is, how can the same code for hybrid sit on iOS, BB, etc., since they have a different OS? So if you see, a hybrid app comprises of two parts, as we saw, right? There is a web, there is a web part, and then there is a native part, and then there is a bridge. So it is a bridge that takes care of ensuring the native component. So if you see, the bridge will provide for iOS, it will provide iOS low-level APIs. For BlackBerry, it will provide a BlackBerry-specific API. When a user writes a code in JavaScript, that bridge, like PhoneGap, for example, will translate that. When you create a build for BlackBerry, it will translate that to a association of your JavaScript code of invocation of a device API to BlackBerry-specific low-level API. That is the purpose of using the bridge. The next question is, can you suggest a MEAP that builds M-Site and native apps for iOS, Android? So IBM provides a solution, Worklight, which is an MEAP, with which you can build native apps as well as deploy it as a mobile site. So Worklight provides an option where you not only can create a native app, hybrid app, complete web app, as well as a pure mobile site. So the next question is there any way to distribute without developer license? So developer license is required for example, for iPhone, and that ensures that every app store certification process. Without a developer license for iOS, you can't distribute unless you want to distribute it to jailbroken iPhones, which is not legal from an Apple perspective. So you would need a developer license for iPhone in order to distribute the new application. The next question is, which are the frameworks tools available for hybrid application development? The PhoneGap is a framework which you can use it for your hybrid application development if you don't want to use any mobile enterprise application platform. Similarly, there is App Accelerator and a couple of other ones which provide you a hybrid application development frameworks. Next question is, how can an app run in mobile browser without an internet? So the web app uses HTML5 offline caching, and it stores some of its logic and data in this offline cache within the browser, and it utilizes that to run it in an offline mode. You can't sync, you can't play against the server. For example, let's take a game of Tetris, you can't play it against the server, but yeah, you will be able to play it on the local mobile handset. That is a capability provided by HTML5 that you can create a web app which is using in a browser without internet. So the next question is, how YouTube is available offline? I believe your example is not right. So we're not talking about YouTube being available offline. We're saying YouTube has a web app which makes it very close to a native app. In order for that app to bring data back from the YouTube server. It has to be connected. But once the data is there, you can't play that. Even for playing, you will need to do run streaming. And for streaming, you will need to connect. So it's about the presentation, how that YouTube web app is being presented rather than building a native app. So even if it's a YouTube native app or a web app, in both the cases, it will need to connect to the YouTube servers to stream the video. So there's no offline capability out there, but yeah, you can build certain functionalities out there which is offline. But in order to play a video, you'll need to connect to YouTube server and you would need to stream that, and for that you would need to be connected. The next question is, you mean to say the YouTube icon is not an app? For certain app, if it's a web app, it's not an actual native app. It is an application, but it's a browser-based app.
Well, thanks, Mr. Madan, for your session on choosing between native web and hybrid mobile application development. It was indeed a great session. I would also like to thank all our participants for the support in making this webinar a success. The recording of this webinar will be available on techgeek.com by tomorrow. Thank you all. Have a great evening.